This lecture focuses on the dynamics of human occupations and evolution of settlements in the oasis of Bukhara, from antiquity to the medieval and Islamic period, completed by some information on Neolithic and Bronze Age. The recent geoarchaeological researches directed under the aegis of the Louvre Museum brought to light the water changes of the Zerafshan Delta since the Middle Paleolithic, generating changes on human behavior which showed from the antiquity an important evolution of settlements and, a few later, a transformation of commercial exchanges. The recent discoveries also carried out the exponential increasing of settlements within the oasis, determining a very tangled network of socio-economic connections between cities, villages, and isolated residences or farm settlements. I will therefore divide this lecture in three main parts. The first one concerned the landscape transformations and the human occupation changes, which is the base to understand the following two parts, which concern the large-scale caravan trade, the Silk Road context to which is linked the local urban context, the city connections, and their economic dynamics. Before it, however, let me please briefly present the global institutional framework and the major axes of this research, which are part of or included in a more global view concerning Eastern Iran and Central Asia. In 2009, under the aegis of the Louvre Museum, in collaboration with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Archaeological Institute of Samarkand and the Özbek Academy of Sciences, I opened an archaeological mission in the Bukhara Oasis. Basically, the objective is to study the dynamics of population and the population of the oasis. It is also to reconsider the urban and the cultural phenomenon in this region, approaching and comparing it in relation with the Khorasanian cities and, further, with the Iranian ones. The first interest of this investigation, therefore, concerns the oasis space, the domestic and urban spaces, and the socio-economic factors in the oasis. In this context, a deep study of the material culture has been engaged. The manufacturing production, local and important, as well as the commercial exchanges with Iran to the west and the east, are a crucial point in this research. This program is constituted of several axes of research: the archaeological excavation at Romitan, Paikent, Iskichkat, Kakishtuban, the northwestern part, the citadel of Bukhara, and the site 250 of which the toponym is still unknown. The satellite and archaeological surveys, the geomorphological study of the region, realized with the collaboration of Eric Fouache of La Sorbonne Abu Dhabi, the topographic work of the main sites of the oasis, the study of the ancient landscape, realized in collaboration with Valerie Androponel of Aix-Marseille University, the historiographical study realized in collaboration with Florian Schwarz of the Institute of Iranian Studies of Vienna, which focuses on the recognition of the main cities of the oasis related in different written sources of the 10th, 12th, 16th, and 19th centuries. The socio-archaeological study, in collaboration with Luigi Tronca of the University of Verona, concentrating on the network system analysis of a part of the cities in the oasis. The ethno-archaeological study, in collaboration with Ilaria Cerrato, working on domestic space as well as on cooking materials. The material culture studies, focused on ceramic, in collaboration with Gabriel Pushnik of the Institute of Iranian Studies of Vienna and UCL, and on glass, with the collaboration of Yoko Shindo of the Oriental Library of Tokyo. All physicochemical, petrographic, luminescence, and radiocarbon analysis are realized with the Laboratoire de Recherche et de Restauration du Musée de France, and the GIS and GIS web elaboration in collaboration with Rilievi SRL from Rome. The intent here is to present some results of this research program through the methodology and the global view of the oasis settlements and its evolution. I will do it through the results of surveys, through the excavation of the main sites, and through the ceramic study, which is still incomplete but already rich in information. The aim is, therefore, to study this region in its territorial and historical complexity through the investigation of the human occupations. This research follows a pathway started 9 years ago when, in a global reflection on Greater Khorasan, I decided to work on the Bukhara Oasis, which is, in some epochs, strongly culturally integrated in this region and globally included in this large network of city connections in the Iranian world and beyond. The aim was and is to identify and study the periods of connection between these territories and the cultural and political links through their evolution. The discoveries realized by the archaeological Franco-Uzbek mission brought to light dynamics of human occupations previously known, showing the chronology and the interaction process between these regions. Some detailed information, geomorphological, historical, and archaeological, has recently been published in different specialized journals, and the full results are being published in a book in Brill this year. Let me now try to explain the causes and the effects which have been at the origin of the geographical and cultural setting which took place during antiquity. The recent geomorphological studies carried out in collaboration with Eric Fouache focused on Zerafshan and Orek Delta, showing structural hydrographic changes to which I input the dynamics of population and depopulation since the Neolithic age. The recent studies of the French Uzbek mission and the previous surveys realized by Russian and Uzbek teams, as well as several excavations inside and around the Bukhara Oasis, as you can see in this slide, have brought to light traces of human occupations dated to different periods and situated in different areas of this vast region. Now, the joint oasis of Bukhara and Karakol, the Bukhara Oasis and the Karakol micro-oasis, is located in the southwestern part of Uzbekistan, covering approximately 5,100 square kilometers. It is bounded to the north by the Kizil Kum, a huge erg, and to the south by the Karakum. On the west flows the Amudarya River with a south-north course. On the east, the Zerafshan Valley is limited by Cretaceous limestone ranges. This area is affected by the Himalayan collision. Active southeast-northwest slip folds can be observed, as well as overlapping fronts in a context of compression, as can be seen along the Kulduktu chain north of the Bukhara Oasis, just here, and between the oasis of Karakol and Bukhara, where a neogene plateau corresponds to a horst. Our studied area corresponds to alluvial plains. The climate of the Bukhara Oasis is an arid one. The Zerafshan water is the only source of water for agriculture and human activities. The Zerafshan River, with a drainage basin of 143,000 square kilometers, originates 741 kilometers upstream from Alamonte, here, and the Zerafshan Glacier in Tajikistan. Until the 1960s, the Bukhara Oasis only received water for irrigation from the Zerafshan River. In the beginning of the 1970s, a canal was created from Amudarya to the oasis of Bukhara, this one. Today, the last part of the Zerafshan River in the oasis of Bukhara and Karakol flows on a northeast-southwest main channel, to which is connected a dense network of irrigation and drainage channels. The geomorphological mapping of paleo channels within the Bukhara and Karakol plains we created in the laboratory relied on different sources, satellite views, spatial imagery, topographical maps, etc. The final map was validated by field observations and revealed eight generations of paleo channels,
that you can see,
that we attempt to date in two ways, a relative and an absolute one. We argue that the location of the settlements with regard to the channels allows for the dating of some generation in a relative way, essentially from the Neolithic to the Islamic periods. In order to establish an absolute date, we used OSL on samples taken down to a depth of 2 meters from different silty and sedimentary layers from every pyrochannel identified on the image and confirmed in the field. These two chronological approaches, I mean the archaeological mapping and the OSL dating, allowed us to reconstruct the generations of pyrochannels and to shed some light on the landscape evolution of the Bukhara and Karakol since the end of the Upper Pleistocene until today. Based on correlations between the periods identified through archaeological data and OSL dating, we determined one pyrochannel dating back to -188,300, one to the -129,600, one to the last glacial period, more or less 20,000 years ago, two pyrochannels active during the Neolithic age, and two pyrochannels active from the late Neolithic and the Bronze Age. I'm just showing the evolution. This path will disappear, then this path, the Kashka Darya, and then the Tsarafshan switched to the northwestern part. Human occupations located along the present time Tsarafshan main channel, especially those at its upper part, such as Iskijgat, just here, and lower part, Paikent, here, as well as those around the Karakol micro-oasis, dated not prior to the 3rd to 2nd centuries BC, determined the last translation of the Tsarafshan main channel, which we situate around the 4th century BC. Overall, we observe the translation of the Tsarafshan River from an active fan centered on the Bukhara oasis to a more active recent one concentrated on the Karakol oasis, this one, showing the extreme mobility of the Tsarafshan River, which dynamic is due to a classic avulsion process. Resuming, the majority of authors explain the abandonment of archaeological sites, especially during the Neolithic and the Late Bronze Age, as due to global climatic changes and regional and local aridification, which is true, and we confirm. Our study also demonstrates the extreme mobility of the channels of the Tsarafshan River and the scope of those shifts on a width of 100 kilometers over the past 10,000 years, those shifts inducing a displacement of human settlements and the main roads. In this new geomorphological dynamic, how have these changes influenced human settlements? Before the 4th century transformation of the Tsarafshan main flow, mostly during the Neolithic and Bronze Ages, the human occupations were mainly concentrated at the end of channels or around lacustrine areas. Different surveys in the past and more recently, confirmed by our investigations, identified important Neolithic settlements northwards, here, southwest and southeast of the oasis. This latter supplied with water by the Kashka Darya River flowing east-west and reaching the Oxus. Bronze Age culture could be identified in the southwestern and western area, here, here, and there. In the current state of research, no Bronze Age traces have been identified either inside the oasis or elsewhere. All the settlements recognized until now have been identified in the same areas occupied during the Neolithic period. It seems that this cultural practice of settling at the ends of channels, as well as in the lacustrine zones, was in use until the Iron Age. According to the archaeological data, no pre-4th century occupations have been identified inside the Bukhara oasis, which, together with the geomorphological data and interpretations, seems to strongly suggest that the inner areas of the oasis were uninhabited because of its swampy and marshy ground. The following transformation, which fixed the last change of the Zerafshan Delta and which determined definite orientation of the Zerafshan towards the southwest, still visible today, has not been dated by yourself simple, but through stratigraphical data coming from archaeological excavation. Two sites have been taken into consideration, by Kent and Iskijgard. The former because it is in context with the last naturally oriented arm of the main course of the Zerafshan, from which the micro-oasis of Karakol originated further down, this one, and the latter because it is located along an ancient meander of the same main arm of the Zerafshan, in the upper part of the oasis. This is the meander of the Zerafshan. Both have been dated by absolute dating. The first occupation of Pykent occurring approximately between the 3rd to 2nd century BC, it could be confidently affirmed that the last modification of the Zerafshan took place slightly before that period. The first occupation of the upstream site of Iskijgard has been dated also to the 3rd to 2nd century BC, testifying that the main arm of the Zerafshan rotated only downstream, slightly above Pykent, in this part. This was the ancient channel and the shift in this one. Moreover, the several sites excavated until now inside the oasis of Bukhara date to not before the 3rd to 2nd century BC, suggesting with very little doubt that the Zerafshan Delta assumed a convenient ground on which to establish settlements from that time. The following centuries have shown an exponential dynamic of urbanization. This phenomenon inevitably caused changes in terms of territory occupation, urbanization, urbanism, technology of water resources, and dynamics of exchange. But this landscape transformation and this massive occupation is in one hand to impute to these changes, and the other hand, it caused behavior changes in large-scale terms, which concern the connections and exchanges between West and East. To explain this point, please, let me start a bit earlier. During the 3rd to 2nd millennia BC, contacts and therefore routes are attested to China and the Iranian plateau. The itinerary undertaken by Andronovian populations toward the south, joining Xinjiang and Marjana, through Pamir and Bactriana, following the route which later would be called the Silk Road, as also attested by Henri Paul Frankfort. At the end of the first millennium BC, historical sources, as well as archaeological discoveries, show a strong dynamic of exchange between China and Iran of Eastern Mediterranean countries through Bactriana, and confirm the route between China and India through Pamir and Bactriana, corroborating for this latter its ancientness amongst the caravan roads. During these long periods, in the western part of Sogdiana, the delta of Zerafshan, as I have previously noted, was oriented mostly east-west and was occupied by populations which settled along the ends of the natural arms of the river. You can see here the orientation to the west. Moreover, the end of the Kashkadarya, to the south, this one, also flowed east-west, approaching the southern part of the Zerafshan in the area of Pykent, both flowing towards the Amu Darya to the west. These areas were, according to our investigations and analysis, swampy and marshy, and in several points, sandy. It is evident that this geographical setting prevented an advantageous passage directly joining Marjana to Sogdiana, avoiding crossing through Bactra. Additionally, according to our data, no settlements existed in this area during those periods due to its inaccessible landscape, which was once again a reason for caravans to avoid this region. The 4th century BC reorientation of the Zerafshan Delta to the southwest towards the Amu Darya gradually transformed the landscape, rendering the ground more accessible to settlements because of this natural ground reclamation, and also to caravan, which only had to follow the main arm of the Zerafshan, crossing the oasis and continuing towards Samarkand or Khoresm, northwestward, or Erkurgan, southeastward. The combination of these effects can be strongly observed by the high degree of occupations in the oasis since the first century AD, the consequences of which would have stimulated the traffic of caravans. In this framework, there are convincing arguments for thinking that the birth of the northeastern route of the Silk Road crossing the Bukhara Oasis mainly dependent on an important geomorphological transformation occurred around the 4th century BC, which generated two factors: a new path directly joining the Amu Darya to the upstream Zerafshan, and a massive human and urban occupation creating the optimal economic and social features for caravans, no matter whether their function was commercial, diplomatic, or linked to communication. Once fixed the causes and the effects generating this framework of increase of settlements within the oasis, analyzed and divided them in different chronological phases through the study of the evolution of the material culture. The first one dates to the 3rd to 1st centuries BC. At that epoch, settlements probably developed from an early unfortified occupation to a defended area, which later became the citadel. The second chronological phase dates to the 1st to 3rd centuries AD. During these three centuries, a global reoccupation of the previous sites has been observed, as well as a strong increase of urbanization, with the foundation of smaller entities identified as bipartite sites, constituted of two urban entities, as we will see below. At that epoch, every settlement was defended by strong ramparts, among which Romitan shows a huge example reconstituted after the excavation. This is the channel of Romitan. This is a reconstitution of the city of the late 3rd, 4th centuries AD. In the central part, you can see the royal palace we are also reconstituting, in which there was a small fire temple, and then occupied also in the Islamic period. You can appreciate the strong fortification of that period, which are not so different from that of Balkh, as well as that of the ancient Bukhara. Here you can see the Shahristan, also with a strong fortification. With an irregular shape. The door is only an hypothesis. And here, the first suburban area of the city, founded during the 5th century AD. Now, according to the analysis and interpretations of the Kulturbe Sogdian inscriptions realized by Nicholas Sims Williams and Franz Grenet, this historical moment corresponds to the power increase of the sedentary meridional Sogdian and Chach against the northern nomadic entities of the vast country state for the control of the territory. Until this period, Sogdiana, and therefore the Bukhara Oasis, was a vassal of the large Kanju state. It is therefore quite normal that in the oasis of Bukhara, people started a dynamic policy of urbanization and fortification. The third chronological phase dates to the 4th to early 8th centuries AD. The first part of this period corresponds to the erection of new urban fortified entities around an ancient fortified nucleus, Shahristan, which stressed a need to expand and at the same time defend the previous urban limits, certainly due to a demographical increase. The second part of this period is also marked by some fortified additions in different cities. The case of Paikent is very emblematic and perfectly synthesizes the dynamic with the foundation of the Shahristan I in the 4th century and this one, and the Shahristan II in the 7th century, the other one. Moreover, in this epoch, some urban agglomerations were provided with well-conceived extramuros commercial, artisanal, or simply domestic areas, the Rabat of the Islamic period. The recent discoveries in Romitan brought to light one part of this area, characterized by a series of rooms oriented north-south along a street, in which interesting materials and tools for production and commerce have been discovered. Not so far to the south, a pottery quarter has also been brought to light through geomagnetic surveys. The largest furnace of a quadrangular kiln excavated gave us material which can be dated with few doubts to the 4th to 8th centuries AD. This commercial and artisanal character existed until the 12th and 13th century AD. Quite well known by historians, this epoch is characterized by a further migration of populations coming from the Middle Sir Daria and the Chach region, this part, giving solid sense to our discoveries and to this demographical and economical increase. The Islamic period from the 9th to the 12th century is characterized by a massive reoccupation of ancient settlements, and it seems, at the current state of researches, by no new foundation. All sites surveyed, with or without Rabat, present pre-Islamic pottery evidences. This period, especially the 9th and 10th centuries, is characterized by the considerable expansion of the urban limits with the foundation of suburban areas, sometime becoming the new Islamic city around the central fortified nucleus. Often this latter was depopulated, which dynamic I also input to the difficulty to supply the city with water and the problems concerning the conservation of the mud brick structures, even if socio-political and religious factors must also be considered. Paikent and Romitan are two emblematic cases presenting, however, different occupation dynamics. In Paikent, founded on a weak neogene relief, thus protecting structures by the water table, the supply of water has always been made from the northern canal outside the city. In Romitan, directly founded on the alluvial Holocene soil, mud brick structures always suffer the proximity with the water table in one hand, and the supply of water later suffered the overlapping of the human artificial layers. Romitan represents an interesting example about the Islamic occupation dynamics of the urban territory. According to our excavations, in the 9th century, the ancient fortified squared city, this one in red, was definitely abandoned for the reasons I explained before. The core of the political power moved to the southwest. A citadel and a Shahristan grew up. In this framework, it is interesting to notice that the pre-Islamic suburb to the west, in which the overlapping of human occupations was already important, was not reemployed as core of the city, but kept its function of suburb. The following period is rather marked by different dynamics of the population of the ancient cities in favor of new close settlement. I identified two macro phenomena dated to the 13th to 14th centuries and to the 15th to 16th centuries AD. Although these two epochs coincide with important historical events, such as the Mongol and Timurid invasions, as well as with two climatic warmer periods in Western Central Asia, it is not yet possible to better and globally identify the causes of this urban depopulation. I'm investigating with Florian Schwarz different scenarios concerning this phenomenon, which by now can probably also be imputed to exponential economic and political growth of Bukhara. The observation of the settlements, of the settlement development within the oasis throughout centuries and the observation of the urban growth led me to study the social dynamics characterizing these events. One of my first interests focused on the distribution of the cities and their topography within the oasis. Then, the development of and distribution of the population within a city. How are cities organized within the oasis? How are people organized within the city? Which factors dynamized the population growth in an urban area? And how are these dynamics globally expressed within the oasis? To treat the urban phenomenon, I decide to analyze in detail the settlements, or better, the tepe, which through their own morphology and location show a different history. After the identification of 1,111 sites within the region, firstly, I operated a morphological selection and divided the tripartite ones, the red point, 53, that were constituted of a citadel and a Shahristan and a suburb, the Rabat of the Islamic period, and the bipartite ones, the blue points, 297, that were constituted of a citadel and a Shahristan. I also selected those that were constituted of only one tepe, called unique tepe, or tepe unique, the yellow points. This last category is composed of every tepe, of which the function has not yet been identified, and which can represent an isolated fortified residence, a classic fortress, or even a mill, etc., etc. Our recent discoveries show that the origin of the majority of the tripartite sites date to the 3rd to 1st century BC. Their suburbs date not before the 5th century AD. Moreover, I observed that the tripartite sites were characterized by a continuity of human occupation since the 3rd century BC to the Mongol or Timurid periods. The 53 tripartite sites, therefore, show a most important longevity rather than the others, which in part were contemporaneous or founded later. It could also be intended that the presence of a suburb, and therefore the presence of a productive and or commercial area, inevitably extended the urban limits and at that time and at the same time gave the city further importance in comparison to the others in terms of economic and social life. Considering this precise oasis space, as compact and homogeneous as that of an endorheic delta, I have observed that this large irrigated region was well divided into different administrative micro-districts around these main cities or local capitals, able to produce and making exchanges, our tripartite sites. Thanks to the discovery of pottery quarters, as you can see in this slide, in which we have brought to light a sequence of decantation basins for clay, potter wheels constituted of a bone axe for the wheel and dumps for rejected object not yet fired, a large basin for drying, this is the sequence of the potter's wheel, the basin for drying object, some small medium kilns, a rod, and then at the end part, huge, large, very large kilns in which a huge quantity of pottery has been brought to light. And also thanks to the discovery of habitats in these same tripartite cities, I observed clear traces of goods both produced and consumed, and goods only consumed and thus probably imported, as well as specific goods, as for example the glazed pottery, exported to the closer cities, bipartites, or individual residences. Resuming, in this particular case, it is possible to determine the dynamic of exchanges in terms of city connections between the tripartite producer cities and the smaller neighboring bipartite cities. The reason for which I categorize the cities turn around the nature of the function of these typologies. The tripartite sites were producer cities, this is from Itan, which offered services. Our discoveries, in fact, brought to light, for example, different pottery quarters and traces of glass production in different sites, as well as commercial or artisanal areas, until the Islamic period, during which this phenomenon largely increased. The bipartite cities were smaller urban centers or villages which didn't dispose of these social services. It's the bipartite cities, the citadel and the Shahristan. They were therefore dependent on the producer's sides, the tripartite ones, exchanging, for example, agricultural goods which were self-produced. In the chronological point of view, these dynamics took place around the 1st century AD, when the tripartite and the bipartite sides were defined within the oasis, but it didn't structure before the late 4th, 5th centuries AD. Epoch in which the suburb structured in well-finished commercial and productive quarters, later the Islamic Rabat. This specific investigation begins, therefore, from this period, at the moment in which the oasis is constituted of larger and producer cities and smaller villages until the 9th to 10th centuries AD. Moment in which Bukhara considerably grew up, becoming not only the capital of the Bukhara Oasis and Transoxiana, but also of the greater Khorasan under the Samanids, although this dynamic started earlier during the Tirids. From a local socio-economic point of view, it is surprising to observe how Bukhara played the role of metropolis, I mean as in the ancient Greek mother polis, welcoming and absorbing population as well as prosperity from the oasis itself or outside. In this context, we found a puzzle of central cities, larger and economically independent, and smaller cities or villages, economically dependent from the former ones. But how apprehend the exchanges qualitatively and quantitatively which organized in the oasis between cities and villages? How recognize the network of the exchanges of materials and specific objects produced, sold, or exchanged in the major centers? Finally, which are the possible organization models of these exchanges? I'm employing in this context the word possible, because in this specific case, I'm elaborating economic and socio-economic models which give an idea of the social organization. The study comes, however, from robust archaeological data acquired from the investigation in the field. Let me give, please, a specific example. In 2012, during the excavation in Romitan, a pottery quarter has been brought to light outside the ancient walled city, which has been later covered by the Islamic city from the 8th century. Amongst the material discovered, a ceramic typology attracted my attention. It concerned large jar with splash slip motifs from the shoulder to the base, sometime red, sometime black in color, this typology. This object is produced in high quantity since it has been brought to light in all different social contexts and all sites. It was used as storage jar as well as Badrab, directly or employed. To my eyes, it represents, therefore, a major typology produced and used in a tripartite city, but also sold and exported to the neighboring villages or smaller cities. I had the confirmation excavating the site 250 near Romitan, in which I observed the presence of this typology in all layers, from the foundation of the site during the first century AD until the Islamic period. This typology of large jar cannot be produced at home, as could be the case for all the smaller ceramic types, especially that used for cooking. Its production needs a specific place because it requests to be assembled from two pieces, decorated with specific sleeves and cooked into a specific kind, etc. Vice versa, the people coming from the bipartite sites exchange its self-produced goods, mostly agricultural, but also cattle. Indeed, people from the tripartite site also produce agricultural goods and managed cattle, but since this specific urban entity was considerably populated, goods were most probably not enough, and they were obliged to sell it from elsewhere. But how represent the dynamics of the exchanges between these urban entities? I will not show you here every possible model we elaborated. I would like only to show the model characterizing the bipartite sites in connection with the tripartite ones, which are linked in this way. Yes, it's not so clear, but in this context, the dynamic corresponds to the demand and the offer, and the smaller cities on the villages, always referring to the same market in the same closer produced city. We create a dynamic of homogenization of the consumption. Example, if several bipartite sites buy a jar typology intensely produced in a tripartite city, we will have a large diffusion of this specific object in these bipartite settlements and probably not elsewhere, in which all the smaller cities are used to buy different objects. More concretely, in the pottery quarter of Paikent, we brought to light only good quality ceramic, fine ceramic. The smaller cities around Paikent, not producers, present a large use of this precise typology of pottery and very less quantity of other coarse pottery, which was probably homemade. To study the phenomenon concerning people within the city, I turned my attention to the current economic studies. If you will excuse me to go so far just for a while, and I bumped into several articles on the distribution of population in determined geographical areas in the 20th century. One of them, in particular, attracted my attention. It was published by Xavier Gabex, professor at the Harvard University, probably now at the MIT, I'm sorry, but actually it revises previous studies entering from the words realized in 1949 by George Zipf's philosopher and linguist at Harvard University. Through a statistical approach, he empirically studied the frequency of words in different languages. His model was later exported to other disciplines. I thus tried to adopt these economic models in our urban cases in a study in collaboration with Federico Trionfretti, professor of economics at Aix-Marseille University. In the context of city growth, economists, but also other scholars on social sciences, know the ratio between the logarithm of population and the logarithm of rank, which shows a model of local growth. Called Zipf's law for cities, it is one of the most robust empirical regulation trends in urban economics or in the social sciences in general. Overall, Zipf's law says that for most countries, the size distribution of cities strictly fits a power law. The number of cities with populations greater than S is proportional to 1 above S. In terms of the distribution, this means that the probability that the size of a city is greater than some S is proportional to 1 above S. This is globally the statement of Zipf's law. But more specifically, in our specific context, I have considered the sites which can be identified as cities, or better, constituted of several urban entities, thus corresponding to the tripartite and the bipartite sites. The construction of the Bukhara Oasis model situates the logarithm of population of the tripartite sites on the x-axis and the logarithm of the rank of the tripartite sites on the y-axis. To calculate the population of the tripartite sites, though it could be the same for all the sites, the bipartite one, I consider the ratio 200 inhabitants for 1 hectare, which should correspond to a high degree of population density between the 1st and the 11th centuries AD, a period during which cities intensively developed, as previously noted. Showing a very different trend since the Islamic period, I decide to put aside Bukhara, which is traded separately. The coefficient resulting from the logarithm is included between minus 1.0624, etc., etc., and minus 0.9001, etc., with 95% probability, which includes Zipf's trend minus 1. Now, beyond these calculations, which for some are uncommon and sometimes displacing, this approach has been assumed to observe the global population distribution of the cities, which were producers and platform for exchanges, and cities which exchanges with them. In the purely economic point of view, this essay proves that Zipf's law could also be used in certain chronologically ancient cases, firstly showing that within the Bukhara Oasis, the city organization and the population distribution growth would not correspond to the production, which supposed a high development of technology, as was the case during the Industrial Revolution, as proved by Xavier Gabex in his study. In our case, exchanges in large-scale term cannot be observed, as can also be observed in the Gabex context of USA cities. The economic development of the cities of the Oasis and this trend of population distribution should be rather imputed to another factor, in my opinion, is commerce. The worth of a city is linked to its commercial power in the Oasis, firstly generated by its commercial services, as for example the markets, which thus become an attraction for people of the same city as well as of smaller villages around it. This phenomenon engenders a dynamic of demographical increase as well as an urban agglomeration. In that epoch, productivity, therefore, didn't create urban agglomeration. Commerce was the true vector of this dynamic. Thank you for your attention.